here with the legend of goalkeeping, Neville Southall. Neville, thanks so much for being with us and giving an interview to the Goalkeeper magazine. It'd be nice if you'd talk about how you first got into goalkeeping, because I think I've read that as a young goalkeeper, you didn't really start playing in goals until you were about 15.
Well, I had two brothers, one older and one younger. So if we ever doing football, obviously, the younger one's too young to go in goal, the older one's too much of a bully to make you. So the only one was going to go in goal was me. So I started there, but I went through my sort of early school, being a goalkeeper, and then I played for the county first season in goal, and then the second season I played centre-half, because there was a lad called Eddie Nidswicky, who lived in the same county as me, who's obviously now coaching at Fulham, played for Chelsea as a goalkeeper, so I played out the second season for my county. And then from then, really, I just played men's football, till I was basically 20, and I moved from Winsford in the Cheshire League to Bury. And then from there, I went one season at Bury, and I signed for Everton on the day that all the houses were on fire during the riots. So it was a nice introduction to Liverpool for me. Well, this is nice, it's all on fire. That's a bit more of a welcome than I usually get. So, yeah, I've always played in goal. I never actually set out to be a goalkeeper, probably a professional goalkeeper, I played for Conwy United in the Welsh League, and we were on £3 a game. I think that's what we had to pay them to play, to be fair. So from there, I actually sort of went to Winsford United, but it was only when I got to Winsford United that I sort of set myself a target. I was done that sort of 18, 19. I thought, where I live in Wales, we didn't have the major motorways at that time. It was a good 2 hours to Manchester, even. Not from London, which is only 70 miles, so it used to take us like a good 2 hours, 2.5 hours. So I thought, if I'm going to actually try and be serious about it, I've got to move to try and get somewhere in England to play so people can look at me.
Yeah.
And then luckily I played a friendly for Winsford United in Cheshire League, and they took me on to play the full season for them. But that got me obviously into Liverpool, up as far as Chorley and around Manchester, really. And that's when, luckily, Bury picked me up.
It's amazing because you make it sound so easy. You were playing centre-back, and then you played in goals a bit, and then you went to Winsford, and then Howard Kendall signed you.
Was easy. All I was doing was doing what I was doing naturally. Look, I didn't have a clue what I was doing in goal until probably I was 25, 26.
Really?
Because most of my stuff I actually naturally learnt myself. So I never had a coach till I went to Bury. I never had a goalkeeping coach at all. And even then it was Wilf McGuinness who took me out in the afternoons. And it was just me and him. And the only bit of advice he ever gave me was, look, when you get in the first team, as soon as you get a catch across, they're going to smash you. So what I want you to do is get up and laugh. And then they don't know what's going through your head. But it works. If you get up and you react, I mean, you can see now, if a forward goes into a goalkeeper, the goalkeeper will get react. If you get up and just laugh at him, he doesn't know what's going through your head. So but next time, because you haven't reacted, they go, okay, we'll leave you alone. So in fact, it was a shortcut, really. I didn't get smashed as many times as a lot of other people because I never reacted. So, it sounds easy, but it was all out of my hands. It's like going for any other job. If someone likes you, they'll give you the job. If they don't like you, they don't give you the job. I was lucky that Dave Connor at Bury quite liked what I did at Winsford, and the added bonus was he used to give me a lift home to North Wales and then drive all the way home myself. So I'd get home at 1 o'clock, he'd get home at 4 o'clock. But unfortunately, once I signed for Bury, within 6 weeks, David got the sack. And a fellow called Jim Harley came in, who I never met. So he had a sign on his hands that really he didn't know anything about.
Yeah.
I went to see him and said, look, you promised me this, promised me that, but I'll do what you want. So really, on my days off, I was still hold carrying. So I was hold carrying even when I signed for
Even when you Bury?
Yeah, but it's double wages because Bury's money was rubbish, to be fair. I think it was on about 150 quid a week at Bury, but I was on more hold carrying. So I actually took a drop, but I thought, well, I can't not take the chance of going to Bury because I can always go back to hold carrying if it doesn't work out. So it's worth actually making our effort. Like 150 quid a week is not big money, is it?
So it was almost as though you were just a complete natural.
Although I ain't got a clue what I was doing, mate, to be fair, and I'd never been coached. So whatever I did, I'd learnt myself or just came naturally. And so nobody ever coached me in goalkeeping until I went to Bury.
What difference do you think goalkeeping coaching can make then? Do you think if you're going to make it, you're going to make it because you'll just be great?
It's very difficult when you say it's like anything. Location-wise, I was struggling. I was really going to get seen. I had loads of trials when I was a kid. I went to Bolton.
Yeah.
And we got beat 6-0 by a bunch of Scousers, but they invited me back, but I didn't actually know that. The fella never told me. So I never went back to Bolton. So the fella who took me never told me that. And then I went, I had loads of trials at Wrexham, but they thought I was too small and too scruffy. So they never signed me there. Because you got to admit, I was, till I left school, I didn't grow. I was probably about 5'8" in most of my pictures. So I was really, really small. Then I went to Crewe and played in goal first half and played centre half, second half, and that was my trial. But funny enough, Harry Gregg was manager of Crewe at the time.
Former United goalkeeper.
Yeah.
And again,
apparently he said he wanted me back, but again, the fella never told me. So really, I've got really duff information on my career, to be fair. So. But funny enough, I really enjoyed the one at Crewe because at least I could play out as well, second half, so it wasn't a complete waste of time. But yeah, some kids on the sideline who were just there to watch, and he may have been playing our team. So I had the really small ones, this really big one. So I had a little bit to do in it in the game.
Yeah.
And second half, they had another goalie, so he said, "Can you play out?" I went, "All right." So I played second half. So it's not ideal for a trial, but I suppose it shows I'm versatile.
Yeah, it's not what you expect, though. I expect you would have said, "Oh, since I was 10, I knew I wanted to be a goalie. I'd go out there every night after school doing, you know," if you hear about Peter Shilton, he said he was, you know, doing, catching the ball every single night after school.
Well, if you're any good, you can catch a ball anyway, can't you? Well, let's be honest, it's, you can either catch a ball naturally or you can't. You know, most people who are natural catchers, you know, you can, cricketers are natural catchers. If you have to, of course, you work on your technique, but I was lucky probably because my technique was okay.
Yeah.
So everything I had was sort of natural, so it wasn't. It wasn't a big thing. I thought, oh, I better go and walk outside. But I never did stuff like that. I trained all the time, but that's my uncle had a team called Landino Swifts who put me in a team at 12, in a man's league at 12. Made my debut at 12 and played a few games for them.
In an adult league?
Yeah, in an adult league, yeah. So, but he, in his wisdom, he put me in against the team that was the most hated team in the area, which was Colwyn Bay, which is like probably 5-6 miles apart. So it was a local derby. And then on top of that, there was a fellow called, I think it was Elvin Morris, who had been playing for Colwyn Bay a legend at Colwyn Bay, and he ran through and tackled me and he broke his ankle. So I didn't have the best of debuts, to be fair, because I had that to contend with the biggest, obviously, rival. Then I broke the fella's ankle by accident, and the game was all right, to be fair. I really enjoyed the game, to be fair. So, but again, he just said, look, if you think you're good enough, go and play. But he was an absolute bugger, to be fair. Because he bought an old bus and we used to drive up this massive hill and he'd drop me off at the bottom and go, right, if you're not on the bus by the time I get to the top, you've got to run all the way back as well. So you just have to peg it up and down the hill all day for him. And he just drove the bus.
Not like these modern coaching techniques.
Well, I suppose it is, because if you think about it now, there's lots of people who do lots of uphill running pre-season, which we did at Everton.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of downhill running for different fibres in your body, apparently. So maybe he was a genius. Maybe he's a genius. But he again, on this bus was, if you've seen the bus, it was absolutely horrendous. But he took us to Dusseldorf to play in Dusseldorf. And we played against the team in Dusseldorf. And then he said to me on the morning after the game, he said, look, they really like you. Do you want to stay here? I thought, yeah, great. I'm, 15? Oh, you want me to stay in Germany on my own? So maybe I could have played in Germany. I don't know. I'd like to think I could have played in Germany.
So did you, when you were learning your technique as a youngster?
I didn't learn anything.
Did you not? You didn't even watch?
I watched all football everywhere, like everyone else. I looked at all the games, I looked at all the goalkeepers, I thought, oh, I wish I could be like that.
Did you used to copy how people dives?
Yep. Didn't do anything. Never ever consciously made the decision to be a goalkeeper ever, until I was older. Everything I did came naturally. The only other thing that changed probably was I did a lot of gymnastics in the youth club. When I was sort of 15, 16, as I was leaving school, I did a lot of gymnastics, and that helped me grow, and that obviously got me a little bit stronger.
Yeah.
And then once I left school, I sort of went playing local football, so I did Saturday morning in my school, Saturday afternoon for a man's team, Sunday morning for a pub team, Sunday afternoon for another sort of kids team. So I was playing 4 games every weekend. So that never really bothered me. And then once I left school, I was obviously playing local football. And I got different jobs with demolition people, did demolition stuff, did odd carrying, did bin men. I did odd carrying, so everything was there and built me up anyway. So I was never unfit, ever. I was always fit. When I went to Bury, pre-season was a breeze. But yeah. My first pre-season session was, he He got us all in the middle of the pitch and went, right, last one out of sight. We had to go and hide behind a bush. That's just some of the things we did in training. So what people go, oh, it's, you know, pro football's really, you know, mystical and all that sort of stuff. Well, we turned up Berry and it was surrounded by big fence, because I think there was either a tannery or a tin works next door to us. So all the fences had spikes on, and he used to go, like, no warm up, no nothing. I tell you what, you've got to touch all the posts and then run back to me. And that was before our warm up. Or she have to do doggies and thought, well, so we now got a sprint, do all that, and then come back. And then if we don't do it, we do a sprint. Or she said, right, last one out of sight, we should go and hide in the bushes. So there's your modern day football for you.
Yeah.
But I didn't, you know. So it was all new to me, so I went, oh, this must be all right, because it's a pro club.
But you went from that, you went from, in a really short space of time, didn't you, from being at Winsford, and then you went Winsford.
Yeah, I think at Winsford I probably grew up, because it's quite a shock to sort of go and play against scousers who want to just kick lumps out, yeah. And to be fair, we had a load of good scousers in our team. You know, real good little mix of scousers, because the manager was a scouser, John Williams, who had really good success non-league.
Yeah.
And they make you grow up, because they actually slaughter you, but they don't have protect you as well, to be fair. So I grew up doing that, and we were in and played all around Merseyside and Manchester, and it makes you grow up, because when I was playing in school and stuff like that, you don't expect anyone to hurt you, do you?
No.
On purpose.
Yeah.
And that's when I learned out that people will actually hurt you on purpose.
What's that like at that level of non-league? That's sort of, that's North West Counties now, isn't it? Compared to when you're in the first division, the old first division,
that's a massive difference.
In terms of people trying to hurt you,
no, because they still hurt you. They're just better at it. Higher up you go, whereas they're quicker, they're fitter, they're stronger, and they've got better brains. The higher up you go, look, everyone can be as fit as anything, but the higher up you go, you rely more on your brains. So the top people rely on the brains, not the bodies, because everybody's fit in the league. From the old Division 2 now, or whatever you call it, League 2, to the top level, they're all as fit as each other. They're probably lower down, they're probably fitter, to be fair. So the only thing that drives you on is your brains. Your brains have got to be better higher up than it is lower down. That's why players, when I finished at Torquay, I found it hard to play at Torquay than I did at Everton. Not because the lads were a bad bunch of lads, but because their way of thinking about football is different. They don't see things as early, they don't have a pitch in their mind.
Yeah.
They react a lot more to things instead of actually seeing him coming like 10 minutes before that.
Yeah.
So if I played at Torquay and I shouted keepers, they'd boot it away. If you shouted kick it away, they just let it go. So there was, because they concentrate so much on the ball, when the other better players, they know what they're going to do like 5 seconds before they get the ball, don't they?
Yeah.
So the difference in the brains is immense. So non-league, you've got another version of that lower down. You get a little bit frustrated. They're making tackles that are not necessarily malicious. But they're getting there as quick as they possibly can.
Yeah.
They're just clumsy and not. There's a few malicious people, to be fair, but you get that in all walks of life.
Well, in that way, then, if it's a bit more of a physical game in the non-leagues, then you get to the top flight.
Top flight is physical in different ways. But again, it's, for me, the Premier League now, or even international football, is 90% physical, 10% fitness. Because your body doesn't move without your brain, does it?
Yeah.
And everyone's as fit, and Most of the internationals now are really slow, 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 quick, and it turns within seconds. So you're actually trying to watch the build-up of the game and see what's going to go on. See, it's like chess, really. See 4 or 5 moves ahead and be ready for that one, because even now in the Premier League, it's counter-attacking football. It's not out-and-out attacking football. It's counter-attacking football. So there's a lot less for goalkeepers to do, but the concentration has to be good. So that's the difference. When I try to do it, it was like, think of concentration in traffic light form. So obviously, if they're up the other end, it's a green. You don't have to concentrate as much when it gets. So they get the ball, and it's a bit amber. Then when they get round you, it's red. So when people say you have to concentrate at 90 minutes for this level,
it's not right.
To me, that's total absolute pants. Because you look at Robert Green in the World Cup. I think he over concentrated. David James over concentrates, and then you go like that, and you don't know why you've made a mistake. It's because you're so much trying to focus on everything
on the whole game.
At that level. Instead of being able to take your concentration up and down, well, you should be able to like relax it a little bit, then take it up and take it down and do that. They don't. They go at that level, and it's really, you can't do it.
Rob Green looked amazingly nervous in the tunnel before the USA game. When you saw,
rightly so. It's World Cup.
Yeah. Well, as it would be. Yeah.
Yeah. So they're all going to be nervous, but you're just hoping. I just think he was thinking about something else. He was over concentrating. So he was thinking, I've got this, that, I'm going to do that. That was his downfall, unfortunately. You know, it doesn't make him a bad goalkeeper, but sometimes you can over, everyone goes, oh, he didn't concentrate enough. Well, he did, he over-concentrated. Because he was too much there. When you're in the middle of all that, you've got to be detached enough to think about what you're doing.
Yeah.
You know, that, you look at boxers are hammering lumps out of each other, but you can see they're going, right, okay, I need to do this, I need to do that, so I'm detached from all the things around the ring. It's the same in football. You're detached from everything that goes around you to do your job, and it's a really funny thing. I suppose it's like being on a really, really busy motorway, and you're concentrating on the one thing you do, because you can only control
what you do.
Your car,
yeah,
or your body, or your mind. So you just worry about that, and then everything's going around you. So it is very much. But if you concentrate on everything around you, and you're trying to look at that, and you're trying to concentrate at that level, then you have a crash, because you don't concentrate the things you should be concentrating on.
Yeah.
So I think he did over-concentrate, but I think everyone goes, oh, you shouldn't be able to do that for 90 minutes. Well, you can't. Why do you? Or tennis players would win all five sets 6-0, wouldn't they? If they were better than the other fellow, it doesn't happen. So the concentration has to go up and down. You have to take a rest here and a rest there, and it does make it easier.
Did you used to get nervous, particularly in the big games? Because obviously that affects your concentration too, when you're too tense.
You should never get... You get nervous, but you get excited. If you get nervous and you get frightened, you're in desperate trouble. It's where a little bit of fear, a little bit of excitement, a little bit of nerves, but the overwhelming thing is, I want to do this. And that's what you got to do. You can only get the experience by going through it. Now, you don't know how it's going to end, either end. You know, when you're walking out of Wembley with 100,000 people, yeah. You know there's probably 100 million.
On TV, yeah.
Yeah, you're not thinking about that. You're thinking about, shit, I hope the day goes well. You've got to just think of that. I hope the day goes well. Now, I've got to go out there. I'm here. If I've got there in my bag of nerves, I'm going to affect everyone else. I'm here. I've got to try and enjoy it. I've got to do my job. So I've got to try and detach myself from everything else and go, that's what I want to do. I stick to that. So you just start getting caught up in the excitement of everything else, you've had it. You know, it's an easy thing to do because your family are phoning you, oh, I've got tickets for this. You've got tickets your uncles you never heard of are phoning you up and say, what about them tickets you promised me? I don't even know who you are, mate. Do you know what I mean? So there's all that as well. So you have to be really, really detached in what you're doing and really think about what you need to do.
Yeah, Van der Sar always strikes me as a goalie who's dead
detached. Well, he's Dutch. Dutch no, but then Dutch are brought up a different way. Dutch are arrogant in the right way. They believe in themselves. It shows in what they do. You know, if I had a goalkeeper and he had the same persona as Van der Sar, I'd be delighted.
Yeah.
He looks as if he's not going to be beaten. He looks as if he knows that he's better than everybody else.
He never looks like he doubts himself. He never looks nervous.
No, because he concentrates on what he's doing, because he's got total belief in his ability. Now, if I'm playing against you, I think I'm better than you. If you end up being better than me, fair play, but I think I'm better than you. I think I can match myself against anybody in the world. What's what we're doing on the pitch? If I go out and you go, oh, it's you. Got not much chance today, have I? What am I going to pitch for? That's why I train. That's why I'm going, right, I'm as good as you any day of the week. And that's a mentality you've got to have. You can't have a mentality where you go, oh dear, I'm playing against him today. Oh, yeah. You know, can't have that. You can't have any fear. But I never used to bother about any forwards. I used to try and click how they finished against me last time. If they scored last time, how would they do it? And what sort of technique they used to. There's clever ones and there's stupid ones, forwards. There's brave ones and there's cowards. You've got to work out what they are. So you're working out, okay, he, not the best finisher in the world, so he smashes the ball. Now, if he smashes the ball all the time, I get a touch, I save it. Him, he'll try and catch me out. So you look at all the different players. If that was a 50-50 and I go for the ball, I know that, you know, I'm going to have to make sure that we go both in hard. If it's another player and I got 50-50, I know that he'll pull out a yard from the ball so I can go take the ball, take him and take everything, because he won't give me a problem. So you've got to know your players who you're playing against as well. So yeah. You've got to do all your homework, but you also got to work out, you know, who they are. And the other thing you've got to know is is what your back four consists of. Because you've got to obviously say, here's my full back. If I shout with him, he goes to pieces. If I encourage him, he's my miles better. But here's my centre-half. He loves being shouted at. He loves being bollocked because that's what he responds to. So you've got to be part of psychology as well, and you've got to try and get the best out of the four in front of you. And once you've worked them four out, you've got to work the four midfield players out. And if you can work your two forwards out, then you go, right, okay, then I can push these people to where I want them to go. So I can say, right, well, when the ball's here, if I get you lot over there, the only ball that the fullback can play is into there, we've already got players there. Now, if that happens, that's fine. Now, if he doesn't do that, then that's going to happen. So you're trying to read the game all the time.
Yeah.
But on the plus side, He'll come out, I know the fullback. But if I get the ball now, I know what he's going to try and do. So if I, that's how he wants the ball delivered to him. If I've got two forwards who are tiny, it's not going to be booting in the air to him all day. So I've now got to work out a system of trying to get my distribution to them better. If I've got two big forwards, really, I can just boot it in the air. How about your days? Do you want to be better than that? Of course you do. So you've got to find out whether they're like, you could drop the ball into them and they could get it on their chest. Or they're just quick, so as soon as you get it, you can release it and they'll run over the top. So there's all them combination of things that make up your team. And that's why if you look at, you look at the Premier League or you look at any football over the weekend and you look at different teams who've got different size forwards and how the goalkeeper distributes the ball to them. You look at Pepe Reina. Pepe Reina is absolutely brilliant doing it.
Yeah.
Of course, each individual, he has his own way of actually putting the ball in. Now, I went to watch Aston Villa a couple of seasons ago when they had the England goalkeeping coach or in charge of coaching Eric Steele.
And I watched now United.
Yeah, he's at Man United down there. Angel up front, and Solskjaer got the ball because he was playing for Villa at the time. And he just lumped the ball near to Angel against Everton, it was. And all he did was hit it away, and I'm thinking, right, I've been on a course for you, and now you're telling me about distribution. I'm going, why is he kicking it 90 miles in the air to Angel when he's not going to win a header? Why isn't he actually bringing it out and trying to drop it into him? So I'm thinking, well, goalie coach gets caught up in the game as much as anybody else. So he's looking at the game as a game. He's not going, maybe, because I think there's a time for you to get in a coach, but I think there's a time for a goalie coach not to sit on the bench at all. Of course, he's not going to affect anything. He might as well sit in the stand and be a little bit more detached and go, I can see a big picture. He should be maybe doing this. But then you go, in the week, because I played with Tony Cott, he was a midget, he's probably your size. Right? And I played with Duncan Ferguson, he was 6 foot odd. Now, Duncan would never let the ball, he didn't want the ball kicked at him. He wanted it kicked straight down the middle and he would stand to the side. And he would attack it from there to, so he'd go from out to in. Tony Cott, he didn't want the ball in the air at all. He'd be quite happy if I could get it, launch it and get it over the top for him. So that means for me to actually get the ball to Tony, Tony wouldn't actually run that way. He would try and stand as close to me as he could. Because then that opens up from the half line to the yard box where I can drop the ball in.
Yeah.
So he's actually bringing the defenders with him this way, so because he knows I'm going to put it over the top for him. So you've got to work out all them different types of things. And that's why as you get older, you start to work on them type of things. And you look at them type of things. But as a coach, your job is to shortcut all of that. So whatever I know now, I should be able to give to a 10-year-old or a 12-year-old. So I'm shortcutting their education. So when they get to a certain age, they should progress quicker than I did at 10. And I think that it's the brains. Yeah, I can work on everybody's body. I can take you out for a million drills. Drills don't do anything.
Yeah, I think
they just make you fitter and quicker.
It's interesting. A lot of goalies will go out and train, and every time they go and train, they'll go and do the physical stuff. They'll go and have shots. They'll do.
And do you know what they'll do? They'll do all the things that they like. They do all the things that they like because they don't like doing the other stuff. Because it takes them out of the comfort zone. Now, when I was coaching at Huddersfield or Bradford, and we know we had a game on a Saturday, then obviously I'm going to come in on a Thursday and Friday and do exactly what they wanted me to do. Because I knew that, well, he loves doing this, you know, throwing the ball on top corner, he loves making all them saves.
Yeah.
So I was always finishing with that. And he'd go off the pitch going, oh, it's great, I want it, it's great, great. You could take him out of the comfort zone early doors, but as long as you finish with something that was what they really, really enjoyed, excuse me, then they would actually go off that pitch going, ah, I feel great. So your job as a coach is also to make that person feel great. I'm really looking forward to match. So your job is to build them as well. And I see so many people going, right, we'll do this, we'll do this, this. My way of doing it is slightly different. If on a Friday, I've got two goalies, and I used to throw the ball and do little side-to-side stuff with them, and go, right, okay, you have 300 catches. How many more catches do you need before you're ready for tomorrow? And they don't know. Because they don't listen to their own themselves. They used to have the coach going, right, you're all right now, go in. If you ask them a question, they struggle. How many catches does it take to make you good? Surely it's how you feel. If I do 10 catches with that friendly, he thinks, I feel absolutely brilliant now. If I do another 20, where's that going? Is that killing him? Is it making him any better? Not really. So you might as well do 10 on a Friday and go home. Because he's ready. What is the point of me flogging a dead horse? Oh, I'm getting paid as a goalkeeper coach. I tell you what, keep going for another hour, because that's what we got. Yeah, I'm earning my money because I'm making him keep an hour, but I ain't doing the fella any favours. So you've got to have a relationship where the goalkeeper actually listens to his own body. See, Everton sometimes, if I did what I needed to do, and I'd put the other goal in and just have shots. So I thought, well, I'm ready now, I don't need to do anything else. I didn't want to go in because there's nothing to do when you go in, so just a few shots to the other goalie. Or play a bit of two touch and then go in. The best goalkeepers are the ones who listen to themselves, who you could take out the pub at 5 to 3 and they'd be ready at 3 o'clock, because mentally they're adaptable. If I've got someone who's really, really nervous at 2 o'clock, but you have to work on him till 3 o'clock to actually get him in the right frame of mind, I don't want somebody like that. I want somebody I can pull out the pub. It doesn't matter what sort of day he's had, whether he's had a row with his missus, whether he's had a crash in his car, whether his uncle's died, whether he's just come out the pub and had pie and chips, I don't want that. I want somebody who can do all that and then can play well, because that means they're flexible in the mind and they're really, really good mentally. I don't want somebody who's going to put me under pressure, because I know as a goalkeeper, just before my warm-up, when I'm doing the warm-up with them, that you put me on edge, because I'm worrying about you now. Because if you don't get your warm-up right, you're starting to worry. Now, I don't want that, because my service then starts getting worse, because I know I've got to be perfect to make you perfect. And that's, you can see that with a lot of goalkeepers. They put the goalkeeping coach under pressure because they worry about things. Now, if you want to do a warm-up, the warm-up counts for nothing. Nobody pays you for a warm-up, do they? Ever. They pay you for playing the main game. As long as you're right for the main game, warm-up doesn't matter. And I think they have done a study with, they took 100 soldiers, and or 200 soldiers, 100 soldiers did warm-ups and did everything, and the other 100 didn't do anything. No difference in the injury rate whatsoever.
In the injury rate?
No difference whatsoever.
That's...
So, do you need to warm up? Don't you need to warm up? So sometimes you got to listen to yourself. So I felt absolutely brilliant at Chelsea 1 year. Oh, brilliant, but I carried on, got sent off. So from that day on, I thought, if I feel good, I'm off. I'm going to get our goals as I can. Because I peaked too early. I didn't want to peak too early. I wanted to be ready. But then I'd go in and just sort of like, okay, 3 o'clock is my time where I sort of in my head what I'm going to do. Well, 5 to 3. Listen to what the manager's got to say half the time, but half the time I didn't. Because it didn't really affect me. Because he was talking about other things.
Yeah, because it doesn't, because the coach is
you've done most of your stuff in a week. So my moment was go, right, okay, so we played Saturday, coming Monday morning, whatever the score is. If we haven't got a midweek game, you're going to go, right, okay, we've just got to try and do what we've got to do. And then Thursday, right, who are we playing against Saturday? Wimbledon. It's just books it in the box about 400 times. Okay, I know the ball's going to spend most of the time in here. So if I got to set my stall up, I think, okay, they're going to put loads of pressure on, they're going to smash it. So it's not going to be one of them games where you go, actually, this is going to be really easy for me. It's going to be a day when I say to my defenders, like, I'll try and come for as much as I can, but it's not going to be clean. I might get a punch and it might land 2 yards from me. I might get a punch and it goes straight up in the air and I might have to try and get another one. It's not going to be a clean day because they won't let me have a clean day. They won't let me come catch the ball nicely. They won't let me punch it nicely without loads of pressure. She goes, well, look, as long as you cover me, I'll try and do that for you. So as long as you don't get frustrated, saying like, my punch only went 2 yards, and you get worried and go, oh, it wasn't a good punch. Well, you don't, because you're doing the job for the team. You're going like, this is what we've decided. This is what we're going to do. This is how we're going to do it. And then I try to take all my positions up, really, to be aggressive in my positions, to make the other person think. Now, if I know the ball's going to go near post corners, I'm going to stand there and stick my hand up. So the fella on the whoever's taking the corner can see me. And I go like that. All right, mate. Right, yeah, but put yourself in this position. What do you do? I'm stood there. He's going to put the ball there. Now, what choice have you got? You ever put it in there, or you go, oh, no, he stood there. So I've already made him think, just by going standing somewhere and making sure he can see me. Now, as he goes back to take it and he's got his head down, I can move back to where I want to be in the first place. So I've now gone, like, okay, if he does put it short, I can still come and get it. But if he changes it, I've still got a chance of getting it. So I can try and outthink him in the first place. So I try to do that with most of the stuff. So I'd take up all different positions that you wouldn't actually say to a kid, you're going to stand
That's
there.
That's where you should stand, yeah.
Yeah, because I'd try and work on it and then try and read the signals. So if he put his hand up and the first ball went near post, but like, okay, I know what one hand means now, don't I? If he bounced the ball and he put it far post, then I know what it means. So I try and read their signals as well. So there's lots of little clues that they give you that way, so you anticipate where the ball's going to go. If they've got 60 yards to the back post and a midget at the front post, you sort of think, well, I think it might go far post here. So you've got a clue by where they stand and what they do and all things like that. So there's a million things you need to contend with, but you do it instantaneously.
It's amazing how much thinking you obviously do during the game. I've played as a goalkeeper a lot and have never thought on that level.
And where did you get to?
Well, that's why I'm such a poor goalkeeper.
But if someone had sat down with you and gone like, what about this, what about this, what about this, what about this, and actually asked you, you'd have been better again, wouldn't you?
Yeah, absolutely.
But then you got to ask yourself, why haven't you done that yourself? Why haven't you gone on going like, I didn't do that well? Look, if I speak to Emma, most goalkeepers common sense. So if you ever struggle, go and speak to a woman. She'll go, oh, that's obvious, isn't it? Just go and do that. And they do. You speak to a woman, they didn't know exactly what it was. That's why I don't mind coaching goalies. Because you go, well, yeah, that's common sense, isn't it? But for a lad, it's probably different. Because the lads always think they know about everything. So you sit down and you coach and you say, well, what about this, what about that? My best coaching sessions ever at Bradford was sat in a pub having a bacon sandwich in a cup of tea. Because I get the lads in and go, right, okay. Get the two apprentices in, get the three pros in and go, right, what about this? What happens if, what about this, what about that, what about that? And it all start coming out to us. You sit back in the end and go, right, I've started your debate, you get on with it. And you sit back and listen to it, and then obviously now and again you go, yeah, but you couldn't do that, or maybe you should do that. You know, why should you do that, why should you do that? And you get all the answers out of them and you're making them think, then it's your responsibility to learn. It's not my responsibility to teach you. It's your career, you're supposed to learn yourself. I won't be on the pitch with you, will I? So I've got to try and give you the ability to think for yourself. If you can't think for yourself, you're not the last. There's just no chance. Is there?
Yeah.
So you've got to learn to think for yourself, and you've got to get information, and you've got to seek information, whatever it is that gives you an edge. You've got to seek all the information you possibly can. So there's lots of things that go on. But there's also lots of people who talk an absolute load of cack about goalkeeping. There is. You can pick up any good book. Look, pick a coaching book, any coaching book you want in the world, right? Sunny day, all the best equipment, lovely pitch.
Yeah.
That's not coaching, is it? Coaching I know is freezing cold day, wind is anything, rubbish pitch, four balls, six cones. That's coaching. Why should you have a perfect... No one has a perfect day. Unless you're incredibly lucky to have a perfect setup. Pros do it. But if you're coaching your lad... Not Wembley out there, is it? Not the best pitch in the world, so you've got that. You've probably got two balls. There we go, I've got my lad. He wants to be a goalkeeper. This is what I've got. What can I do with it? Well, at Bradford, I had two lads who had bad shoulders and bad knees. So I would do most of my sessions when I just sat them down. And I could do an hour and a half, 2 hours with them sitting down. They ended up catching 500-600 foot footballs. So you're working on a technique. You can work on a core stability. You can work on deflections. You can work on anything you want. Can work on the vision. It's just once you get that one drill, your one drill, whatever your one drill is, you should get at least 10 to 20 drills off that one drill, because you adapt it. You know, you adapt it to everything. You give them situations like, how many times do you stop the ball with the back of your hand in the game? It may never happen. Yeah. But if you practiced it and it does come, you'll be ready.
You can do it, yeah.
So you try and get right, okay. So if I'm throwing the ball from you, you've got to have to, so if I sit him down here now, and I threw the ball from back there, I would expect him to stop the ball with the outside of his hand. So he should be able to feel roughly where the ball's going to go, and be able to turn, so you can work with your left. You can sit down and do it. And I did that because a lot of the players were injured. So you can do an awful lot of work with them when they're injured. Or when they carry a knock. You can do the whole session, 2 hours, whatever it is, sat down, and make it interesting for them. Also, but your job as a coach is to come and deliver lots of different things in different ways to stimulate your goalkeeper so it doesn't go right. We know that drill. I've had goalkeeping coaches go, same drill every single week. You know it's coming in, you know it's going to be hard, but you know it's going to be boring. Do you want that? No. You've got to get inside their minds, you've got to stimulate them, and you've got to make sure that they're really, really excited about coming to training. They look forward to it. At Bradford, we did volleyball, we did head tennis. But volleyball and badminton is just what you need to be a goalkeeper. Body going forward, attacking balls, blocking, reactions, speed, footwork, balance, coordination. How much more do you want? Communication, teamwork. You get everything by playing volleyball. Same as you can get everything playing badminton. So you look at that and you go, okay, well, I can take that sport now. And to make a change for these kids, we'll play badminton. And they'll go, well that's nothing to do with goalkeeping, but it is. It's everything to do with goalkeeping. You don't play backwards at badminton, hardly. Only when it's a lob. Volleyball, it's all about movement. So anything like that. So you can do loads of different things and loads of different sports come into being a goalkeeper. Part weightlifter, part gymnast. So there's loads of different sports that you can actually bring into goalkeeping. You've got to get your body up, whether it be 10 stone or 15 stone, you've got to get your body up to top corner. How do you do that? We've got to be part of the gymnast. You've got power in your legs. So you look at gymnasts, how they train. Look at athletes, high jumpers, how they train. So you look at everybody that you can actually pinch bits off and look at everybody and go, right, oh, that's how I can improve. And if you're a coach, you're looking at other sports going, actually, wicket keeping. You've seen wicket keeping.
Yeah.
Why do they take the ball? And I'm thinking, why don't you just stand up? Because all they catch is still when you stand up. So why don't you just stand up in the first place? Why do you always crouch behind the stumps? Why don't you just stand up? Because you're going to stand up anyway. I know. So I think, well, just stand up and catch a ball. How simple can that be? So you look at the other sports, you know, hockey. When the hockey goalies come, they come flying out. Why do you come flying out? That ball is travelling probably 60, 70 mile an hour. So if you hit it from the edge of the D and I'm stood in goal, I've got half a chance of saving it. If I'm this close, the only way I'm going to save it is if I block it. Why don't I buy myself some time by not rushing out like an idiot and just stand there and say, right, go on, beat me. So surely all my training must dictate that if I'm in this goal, you ain't going to beat me. So no matter how hard you whack that ball, my goal's only this big. So I should be able to save it. So you look at all the other sports and you think, well, you can improve that, you can improve that, improve that. So, but it all comes down to one thing. It's here. Not fitness, it's all here. That's why goalkeepers go on longer than everybody else. Because they can think their way through games.
And a lot of them, especially at the moment, you've got people like Friedel, Van der Sar,
Brad Friedel and Van der Sar are old school goalkeepers. I don't think any other goalkeeper will go on longer than that.
Don't you?
No.
Yeah, I see it now.
I think you've seen an age where goalkeepers are packing at 35.
I think so.
Yeah. Because Brad's old school, determination, character, wants to play. Some of the other ones, can you see the Arsenal goalies going on till they're 35? They're cack now. I wouldn't expect them to go on to 35 in all fairness. Like, they're not good enough now. So at 35, how bad are they going to be? They haven't improved, have they? You know, you can go through all the Premier League goalies, right, and you look at them, you go, right, Pep Mourinho has improved, yes. Right, whether it be through him or coaching, he's improved. Jaskalainen, has Jaskalainen improved? No. He stayed exactly the same. Why has he stayed exactly the same? Van der Sar has improved, improved, improved. He's got to an age where they think, he's had enough. So you look at the goal and say, well, have they improved? No, why haven't they improved? Who stopped them improving? Well, it must be them. Or it must be the environment that they're working. If you're 36 and I'm your coach and I'm going, well, we'll just do this and you just tick over, I'm doing you a disservice. You're 36, you must be able to get better.
Yeah. I mean, David James, I would have thought was a good example. Yeah, but David James is also great last few years.
But David James is a complete and utter waste of talent. David James should have been the best goalkeeper in the world for the last 10 years. He wasn't because he got caught in various other things. Physique, spring, he had everything to be the best goalkeeper in the world by miles. Just mentally, couldn't cope. Until he got older.
Until he got older.
And he's gone from his head being all over the place to his head going, settling down.
Yeah.
And now he's starting to think his way through games. He looked miles better. And to be fair, I thought he should have played in the World Cup. I think England would have been far better with him in the World Cup. Not because I don't like Robert Green, but because I think at his age and where he'd been and what he knew, he'd be handling it better than everybody else. He loves big games. He's not afraid to make mistakes. Distribution is different class. Presence is great. But if you reach a certain age, you shouldn't actually go, that's it. I can't get any better. So I don't think you ever reach your peak at 28 anymore. I do honestly think, for me, it was 35. I was a man. I was as strong as I possibly could be. I was as fit as I possibly could be. And I had all them games in the bank. So for me, that 35 was my absolute peak when I felt absolutely magnificent. And I still think that if you're old school, you get to 35, you still want to play. I think you could be at your peak. Trouble is, at 100 grand a week, whatever you say, it makes you softer. And you can look at the players in the Premier League, and you know the ones that would play without money. You know, Steven Gerrard, Frank Lampard, they play if there's no money. They play if it's 200 quid a week. They still want to play. John Terry, another one. Giggsy, another one. You know, to be fair to Gary Neville, Gary Neville's like that, Phil Neville's like that. They play and they want to play football. You know, the other side is coincidental. Rooney wants to play football, not interested in anything else. If Rooney stops playing football, he's going to go bonkers, isn't he? Because he's got this similar traits to him and Gazza, not on the sort of drinking stuff and all that, but because he's involved in football that much, has he got enough to survive outside of football? That's the other worry, is when you come out, you've got to have enough to survive mentally. And some of them can't because they live and die for football, and there's nothing else for them. So there's a lot that goes on, but it's not as mystical as everybody thinks for football. I don't think it's just perceived to be mystical by people who. Look, I've worked with some horrendous people in football. I've seen some better people in non-league than I've in pro game. I still, and they still are. Look at a player from the Vauxhall Conference or lower down. They work a whole day.
Yeah.
They travel, go and play a game, get back and go back to work. And then they train twice a week. And then you got somebody in the Premier League on 200 grand a week and goes, oh, I'm really tired this week, I don't think I'll play. Now, how does that equate? I don't get it. I really don't get it. I just think that's just... Why would you want to miss a game? How do you know when you're going to get injured? How do you know when it's all going to finish? So surely you should play as much as you can. And being a goalkeeper, you've got to play every week. It's no good playing all the games. You've got to get into your groove and you've got to get into your match fitness and you've got to play every week because it's pointless playing every other week or once every month. And that's what Shea Gibbs find at the moment. He's finding it really, really difficult because he can't get a game. So his sharpness is going. So I do think there's an awful lot you can, about goalkeeping that people misunderstand. Drills are great. Thinking's better.
That's amazingly interesting advice. I think there's a lot that's written about goalkeeper coaching, and not a lot of it, definitely not the way you've put it, is focused on the mental side of things.
No, because you're trying to sell a book. But, we can sit here and we can devise 10 drills today and we can put it on your website. Without the things that go with the drill, the explanation and the talking to the people, then what's the use of the drill? Fitter, stronger, quicker doing it. Great. Do you relate that to a match situation? So you're coaching me, so I go, how do you relate this to a game? Well, you make a save in a game, don't you? Relate it to a match. Relate it so the kids can actually see a picture in their mind when you go that top court. Oh, I see what you mean, yeah. So if I made a save like that, and I get up and I've got to do that, so you can picture it in the mind. So you paint a picture for them. Here you go, here, this is what's in your mind, this is what you go. This is why we're doing this drill, because of this. Oh, okay then. Doesn't go and go, what do you do today, son? Oh, we did this, we did that. Why did you do that? Because he told me to. And that's the difference. You've got to get to know the kids. It's really difficult. And the other thing is you've got to equate it to everything else the kids do. If I'm coaching you, and you're at school doing PE all day, because that's your subject, and you do it two or three times a week, and you're doing running in PE, and you're really, really working hard, and I get you at night, and I'm going, right, oh, we're going to do a hard session, I'm doing you a disservice, because I'm going to kill you. It doesn't bother me, because I don't feel a thing. So I've got to be aware of everything else you do. I've got to be aware of what you eat, how you sleep, what music you listen to, you know, what your environment is, who your mates are, how much time you spend outside, how much time you do your running. The one thing I would say about everything is that I don't see any kids who can touch their toes anymore. Because they have no flexibility whatsoever. I would like to see, obviously you'd like to see in schools, that all the sports put money into a pot. So they teach them all the sport. So they teach them the basics. Footwork, balance, coordination. Nothing else. And then maybe some little hand games later on. So, but they start off in primary school only doing that. Because you'll drift into your own sport eventually. Because you'll be good at boxing, good at cricket, whatever. But cricket, you can relate that to goalkeeping. Because if you want someone to bend forward as a goalkeeper and be on the toes, pretend you've got a bat in your hand. Hockey, pretend you've got a racket in your hand. So you can, all them sports can equate to goalkeeping as well. There's tons of stuff you can do, but I think the government have got to go, tell you what, whatever sportsmen we would produce, they've got to have balanced coordination. Otherwise, they're not going to be sportsmen. Or they're going to be worse sportsmen than the ones with good balance and good coordination. People with good coordination, good balance, always going to be sportsmen. And if they're quick, it's even better now. But if you get them things in place, then they'll drift into their sports, won't they? But all the sports compete for the same kids. Instead of going, there's your basics, and then we're happy that we'll put on all these other things later on. Get the things right first. And you find it much easier, you find much better sportsmen, I think, as well. So you just got to look at that and think, well, it's political. And it's a stupid way of doing it. And the schools have got were better when they did dance, because at least dance and stuff like that were working on things you should have done. And they now brought in SAQ stuff in schools, or whatever they call it now. We've done it, multi-skills it's called, where we've done it. And basically it's the three things, but it's an after-school club for kids who haven't got very good coordination, who struggle with work. But if you've got good coordination, you really work on your high-hand coordination, your writing's better, your concentration's better in school, so your kid becomes a better pupil in the first place. So why don't they all do it? Why don't they all do the first hour of coordination, balance and eye-hand coordination? And you'll find that the writing's better, find the concentration's better. You'll find out you're blown away all that stupid stuff before they start school. Now I'd like to see the education system do that. It won't, though. It's too easy.
I think we're going to ask you some questions from some of the readers in a minute, but I've got probably one or two questions that you probably get asked a lot. Have you got a favourite save that that you ever made during your career?
No, because I expect to make saves. I didn't expect not to make a save. So it depends which way you don't look at it. I remember all my mistakes that drive you on to be better than what you were, but I just expected to make saves, because that's what I did all week. I worked that way of doing it and then put it into practice. That's like you telling me, well, I've learned to drive this week, do you think you can go around that corner? And when I went around the corner, you go, oh, that's unbelievable, mate, I wouldn't have done that. It's what your expectations are. I expect to make saves. It is, when you make a save, it's just the timing of the game and how big the game is.
So you didn't feel particularly proud when the crowd's going crazy, you've just...
Look, when you make a save that everyone perceives to be great, the crowd have an intake of breath for a second, and then that's how you know the save's decent in their eyes. It's because you hear that, whoa, and it's that. I suppose that's what goalkeepers live for, I suppose. Because you can always remember that it goes really, really quiet for a split second and then it just bursts. But you can understand why, you know, performers love it and things like that. So, yeah, I suppose whenever you make a save like that, you're okay, that's different from that one. Run a mill save, you go, yeah, hold on, mate, yeah, should have saved that, shouldn't you? But I do look at how we did things, and I look at the Premier League now and I think, standard goalkeeper's absolute drivel. They don't get the same challenges, they don't do the same things, they don't catch the ball hardly, It's more show than it is goalkeeping for me. They don't do what they're supposed to do. If I played now with the same manager that I had, he'd have dropped me after 2 weeks because I never caught the ball. He'd have dropped me if I give a call away. He'd have dropped me if I give a free kick away. But their standards have gone so low, there's no contact. And that's why everybody in football moans about Stoke City in the Premier League, because goalkeepers have to contend with pressure and contact. You look at it, all their injuries are not contact injuries anymore, really, are they? It's the odd one, but hardly most of them are done sprains and because the pitch is hard. Not contact injuries anymore.
I think one of the things that's really changed in goalkeeping technique since, say, the 1980s to now is how goalies handle one-on-ones. I think you see a lot more goalkeepers coming out now and they won't go down at the player's feet. They'll stand up. And Rayner's a great goalkeeper, but he's someone who always stays on his feet when he's coming out to an attack.
Well, look, if you're coming through against me, whose job is it to score a goal, mine or yours? It's your job to score a goal, not mine, so why should I move? It's your problem, mate, not mine. You get paid more money than I do, you try and score past me. Why should I dive? Why should I give you an opportunity to beat me? Stay where you are, it's your problem, mate, it's your pressure. You deal with it, not me. The hardest thing in goalkeeping is just stand there. If you stand there, not a problem. Because they're under pressure, you're not under pressure. You're never under pressure. Because you're supposed to score. So you pile all the pressure back onto them. That's your problem, you do it. If you score, great. If you don't, it's your own fault. Just wait for them. Or if you're incredibly clever, you dummy them. You pretend to go one way waiting for the ball the other. Depends how clever you are. One-on-ones. If you're running through at me and I'm going to dive at your feet, do I faint to go left knowing that you're going to go right? Do I faint right because I know you're going to... And I show you that side, so I'm already going, this is where I'm going. You go, oh, he's going that way, I'll go this way. So you try and trick him, and you try and get him. So you've got to think about how you want to get the ball. How stupid are you? If I can double you, how stupid are you? Can I do it? Are these single man enough to go, I'm going to do this no matter what? But if I go this way, what's your next reaction? Mr. Go that way. Now I've trapped you. So I just try and set traps all the time. to, if you're clever. It'll work. You try it on a Sunday morning, it works, because most people are thick. Yeah, most forwards are thick as shit. Pardon my French, but they are. Because you'll go, you can trick them. But when you do your coaching books, it doesn't say, actually, try and trick them, does it? It goes, well, stay up as long as you can, blah, blah, blah. Well, yeah, but take it a stage further. How brave and how good are you? Can I dummy you? If I can dummy you, great. But only use it now and again. But it works. I've done it. It does work. Depends how brave you are to try it. Depends how good you are. Depends how much work you've done in a week. But if you can actually get into that frame of mind where you go and detach from everything else, you'll come forward. Okay, let's try it. See what happens. Try it in training. It works in training. Because it does. If you say to go, look, do this and do that, it works. You've got to take it into a game. And you've got to be brave enough to take it into a game and think enough about the game and go, you must be able to do this. So I'm saying it physically has no bearing on it, does it? Mentally, it has a massive bearing on it. So, yeah, everyone's fit, but brains win. Brains always win over brawn. Unless you're in a very, very small room. So it does, but so that's why your thinking's got to be... That's why you've got to get people to think for themselves. Because you're not going to be on that pitch going, look, stand up, stand up, stand up. You can in training until you get into them. But I can honestly remember actually saying to myself during the match, or when someone's come through, stand on your feet, stand on your feet, stand on your feet. And you're saying it mentally, stand on your feet, stand on your feet, stand on your feet. It's his job, it's his job. You get into that and you go, okay, now you beat me. And he might be this close. But it's your job, mate, to score. Pressure's on you, not me. You don't know how close anybody else is to getting a tackle in. You don't know how far away anybody is. Pressure's on you. You deal with it, not me. Pressure's off me. So it's all for me. It is massively mental, not physical. Because physically, I've done all my training. I'm as fit as you. I don't worry about a shot there because I've done all my training. So the other thing is, you see goalies coming out like that now. I'm thinking, well, why are you going like that? Surely, if you don't know your training, you don't need to do that because you're not worried about that. What are you saying to me, as a forward? I'm really worried about that. So I'm compensating here. You're telling me everything as a forward, aren't you? So now I'll just go, oh, and you'll go down early. And I've done you, but you've shown me where your weakness is. Why do it? Why don't you go, your problem, deal with it. It's much simpler. And again, Em would probably say, common sense. Why do you need to show anybody weakness? As a goalkeeper, you've got to be a chameleon. You've got to camouflage all your faults. So you go, oh, how should we beat him? It's not bad in the air. It's all right on the floor. It's quick. He won't go down too early. There's you. Got a good presence. Well, there's your problem now, isn't it? You've got all them things in your mind you come through because you've seen me and you go, oh, he's not bad at that, he's not bad at that. So people start thinking, well, he's not bad at this, not bad at that, not that. So he's quite good at it, isn't he? So you know what your faults are, so you're constantly working on them in training. But I certainly ain't going to go out and go, by the way, I'm rubbish at my left side, so I'll go and stand on the left side. They go, you don't see that, do you? But they go like this. Oh, what are they worried about? Do your training. Do your training, not worried about that, are you? You should be confident there, wherever. And that's why I think you show signs of it. You go, what are you doing? Any forward worth his salt will go, what's he doing? He's really worried about that. So I'll feint to go there and put it over the top of him. And he goes, well, I ain't going to get beat there. If I get beat over my shoulder, oh, it's not my fault, is it? Well, it is because you're 6'6". So you shouldn't get beat in the air, really, ever. So yeah, if you've done your work on the floor, you shouldn't get beat on the floor. So you should have a complete package. But what they're saying is really, I've only got 3/4 of the package. You need to have the whole package to be a proper goalie. So you remember that next time, won't you?
Yeah, well, okay. Going to go and do a session this evening.
But don't you get it? It's not about anything else. It's about you. It's about you thinking. That's it. But my job as a coach is to make you think. Because you know yourself better than I know you.
Yeah, should do.
Well, yeah. I don't know, because our mates, he works at Man City, haven't done anything, and he used to phone me up after every single game. I said, what about this? He said, shut up, man. I still get it now. Well, I did this, what about this? You know, it was blowing a gale, and I had all the defenders on the 6-yard box. I said, well, like, why? Why? Because you're inviting pressure. Why don't you just get him to stand in the halfway? Like, if he's going to boot, over the top, you can get it. So most of it is common sense. You just look at the weather conditions, you look at the pitch, look at your players, look at everything, and you go, let's work out a strategy, how to win this and how to do it. Playing with the wind, do you want to kick it too far? Where do you place your forwards? And that's the kind of thing that you look at the kids and go, look, if it's a really windy day, would you put your defenders all the way in your box head of ball? Why? Why would you do that? Because if they drop, they're going to drop inside the box. do you want to get from a goal kick all your players inside your box? Well, not really. So what are you doing it for then? So you've got to set scenarios up for people that are going to go, right, okay. We used to do at Bradford, there's a free kick here, 40 yards out on an angle to the touchline. What would you do? Well, I'd have two in the way. We're not going to score for 40 yards. Why are you having two? Well, in case you shoot. He's 40 yards away. But it's their perception. You know, it's the simple stuff is the what. Have you seen the walls on telly when the goalie builds walls? Right, there's a crossbar there. Walls go. What's that saying to somebody? Shoot through that gap. If you have the wall like that, tallest one down, that means I'm buying my time to get across a goal. So my tallest one's covering the top corner. If he gets the ball up and down in a space like that, boy, you're just standing and clap. So you go, your wall's got to go that way. So it's got to slope to buy you time enough to get across. So each time he's got to get the ball over, the gap then increases towards you. So you're going to say, now I might only have to cover three quarters of the goal instead of half. So it's about how you set up the wall. Is the size of your players you got and where you want the ball to go. But you want the ball to go wherever you want it to go. So the trick is to get you to get the ball where you want it and get the people to do what you want to do, not react after it's done. That's what I'm saying. When I was younger, I just reacted to everything. And maybe instinctively took positions up where I didn't have a clue why I was doing it, but I just did it and it did come naturally. But some people, only later on when they've gone, oh, that's why I did that. This is why I did that. But you don't know until somebody else sits down and tells you, do you? But then your job is to shortcut the next person so he has that knowledge. So you have to give that knowledge and you have to sit down with him. So I'm saying, why should I take you out on the field and do 10 drills when I can actually sit here and talk to you? Would you learn more if I did 10 drills outside? Or would you learn more in here talking to me? Only you can answer that.
Yeah.
And?
Well, no, the whole point you're making is that you, as a goalkeeper, you've got to be constantly thinking for yourself and learning for yourself so that you can then improve on your own and it's
well,
not always
somebody
else.
Would you think if I took you out there now, you'd learn more than what you learn now?
No way.
No. So when you have any sort of books and obviously you've got your website, there's questions going to come in for you. There's all different things that are going to come in. It's an individual thing. So it has to be quite individual. Now you're what, 5'6"?
Oh, I think I'm 5'10".
Oh yeah? Well, you sat down, right?
5'6".
Right, okay. And you're probably what, 9 stone?
A bit more than that.
Well, let's say you're 5'6", 9 stone.
Yeah.
Now, there you go, geezer on the camera, 6 foot odd. Probably 12 stone. You're not going to have the same things as him, are you?
Yeah.
You're different to him, so you're going to have different things. So you look at all the coaching books, they don't go into, well, actually, if I've got a 14 stone, 3 foot six goalie, I've got to treat him differently than if I've got a 6 foot seven goalie.
Yeah.
Because his problems are different from others. You're probably slightly quicker on your feet than he is. Big, tall goalies, quite slow across the ground, so you think you'd work on that. Small goalies are always going to be quick on the ground. Of course, God compensates everything. You're quick, but you might not have the height. He's big, hasn't got the speed. So you've got to concentrate on all that as well. So, but most coaching books go, well, everybody's the same size, the same weight, same shape, and otherwise the same problems. They don't. They have different problems because of what of the build. So when you're doing your coaching, you must try and find out as much information about the person that you're coaching. So when people are going to ask you when you come on this website, they're going to go, give me a training tip. Okay, I'll give you a training tip. Do this, do that, do that. How big is he? How old is he? How fit is he? Is he really keen? Does he understand? Do you talk to him? So there's all them other things round the question. So you can ask one question, but it would be nice on your website probably to have a discussion rather than a question. Because discussion is the way that everybody finds out the answer rather than one question going, is your house black? Yes, it is black. Then somebody go, that's it. But if someone says, is your house black? Yes. Somebody else will go, why is it black? So you start getting answers from different things. I think it does make a difference if people have this thing, well, if I ask this question, it's going to fit my kid, and it won't fit your kid all the time. So something you've got to make your questions, if they're going to send questions into you and they're going to ask things, it has to be personal, it has to be a little bit of information. It's not going to say, now I've got a 14-year-old kid who's bad at this. Well, if that 14-year-old kid can't run, can't move, he ain't going to be able to do that, is he? So what I can teach you this bit, he ain't going to do it if he can't do this bit. So there has to be a little bit more. So if they ask a question, they should give a profile of the goalkeeper to you. he's basically this, quite good at this, his technique's quite good, blah, blah, blah. He's really keen. Really keen, what does really keen mean? Really keen mean he might be absolutely rubbish, but he wants to do it. Do you know what I mean? So that's probably, if you can individualise it a little bit, then I think you find you give better information out than what's on the internet at the moment. I'm often find out with these questions.
Yeah. So, yeah.